أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. لقد أرسلنا رسلنا بالبينات وأنزلنا معهم الكتاب والميزان ليقوم الناس بالقسط. صدق الله العظيم.
الحمد لله الحمد لله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى خصوصا على افضلهم وخاتم النبيين محمد الامين وعلى اله وصحبه اجمعين. اما بعد فاعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الف لام ميم. ذلك الكتاب لا ريب فيه هدى للمتقين الذين يؤمنون بالغيب ويقيمون الصلاة ومما رزقناهم ينفقون والذين يؤمنون بما أنزل إليك وما أنزل من قبلك وبالآخرة هم يوقنون أولئك على هدى من ربهم وأولئك هم المفلحون. صدق الله العظيم. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي امري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي. اللهم ربنا الهمنا رشدنا واعذنا من شرور انفسنا. اللهم ارنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه وارنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه. اللهم وفقنا لما تحب وترضى. امين يا رب العالمين. As I told you in the introductory lecture, we are now beginning with the first grouping of the surahs. The Makki surah was Suratul Fatiha, which we have already studied. Now the Madani part of this first group consists of four surahs, and consisting of two pairs of two surahs each. Suratul Baqarah, Suratul Ali Imran, they are a pair. And that is evident from the fact that both start with the letters Alif, Lam, Mim. Then Suratul Nisa, Suratul Maidah, they are a pair. They start straight off. Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, ya ayyuhal nas. This is how Suratul Nisa and Suratul Maidah start. So this is the first pair of the Madani surahs. Now regarding Suratul Baqarah, please note, this is the largest and the biggest surah of the Quran. It comprises nearly 2.5 parts. It has 286 ayat, divided into 40 rukus. And this Suratul Mubarakah, not only regarding its size, it's one of the most important surahs of the Quran, rather I should say the most important surah of the Quran, because it has been said so by the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself. There's a hadith in which he said, لِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ سَلَامٌ وَسَلَامُ سَلَامُ الْقُرْآنِ سُورَةُ الْبَقَرَةِ. Everything has its top, highest place. And we may say every phenomenon has a climax. And the top or the climax of Quran is Surah Al-Baqarah. Now these are the wordings of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This surah, I have given it a name, Suratul Ummatain, surah of two ummas. The two ummas, that is the present Muslim ummah, that is the Muslims, and the former Muslim ummah, the Bani Israel. This surah can be divided just as we listen to the Hadith al-Qudsi, Qasamtu salata baini wa baina abdi nisfain. Suratul Fatiha divisible into two absolutely equal parts. Here again we have nearly equal parts, halves of Suratul Baqarah. First part, that comprises of 18 rukus and 152 ayat. Here, the address is basically to the former Muslim Ummah, that is Bani Israel. Out of the 18 rukus, more than 10, you know, they are in direct address, Ya Bani Israel, Azkuru ni'mati allati an'amtu alaykum, wa'fu bi'ahdi, yufi bi'ahdikum, wa iyaya farhabun. This is the beginning of the fifth section, fifth ruku of this surah. And in the 15th section again, Ya Bani Israel, Azkuru ni'mati allati an'amtu alaykum, wa anni faddaltukum ala al-alameen. It's a continuous address to the former Muslim Ummah. In the first four rukus, there are some preliminary discussions, and as we shall see inshallah very soon, actually they are a summary of the whole of the Makki Quran. Because two-thirds of the Quran had been revealed already when Suratul Baqarah was being revealed. It is Madani Surah. And this is the first Madani Surah. The time of its revelation is beginning with the Hijrah till the time just before Ghazwatul Badr. So that is actually about 16 or 17 months. This surah was revealed bit by bit, part by part, during 16 or 17 months, extending from just after Hijrah to just before Ghazwatul Badr, the Battle of Badr. So this is the first Madani surah that way. But two-thirds of the Quran had already been revealed. That is the Makki surahs. So actually, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed this surah in the very beginning of the Quran, a gist and a summary of the teachings of the Makki Quran is given in four rukus in the very beginning of this surah. Then the four remaining rukus of this first part, they are tahwili, because you will find that the change in the direction of Qibla from Jerusalem to Makkah, that is discussed in those four rukus. And that was actually a symbol that the position that was held by the former Muslim Ummah, Bani Israel, for 2,000 years, now they are deposed from that position. They were the representatives of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on earth for 2,000 long years. Now they are deposed, and the new Muslim Ummah, based on the prophethood of and messengerhood of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, now this has taken the place. This new Ummah, it is being installed in place of the former Muslim Ummah. That is why the direction of the Qibla, that is changed from Jerusalem to Makkah. Then the second part, second half of this surah, it comprises of 22 rukus, but the number of ayat is 134. In the first part, 18 rukus, but ayat 152. In the second half, although the rukus number is greater, 22, but the number of the ayat, 134. So actually they go to balance each other, and that is how I'm saying that they nearly balanced half and half, you know. This division is nearly balanced. In that second portion, the address is to the Muslim Ummah exclusively. And two subjects are being discussed. Number one, the Sharia, because the Sharia is revealed after Hijrah. Before Hijrah, there was no Sharia actually, no law. Nothing had been made farz except, you know, Salah. And that was also made farz only a year or so before Hijrah. There was no Zakah, there was no Saum. Nothing was declared haram. You know, neither, you know, liquor was declared haram, nor interest was declared haram. No Sharia. So Sharia actually was revealed in the Madani Surahs. And in Suratul Baqarah we find the blueprint, the basic principles, the blueprint of the Sharia of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this goes to develop into Suratul Nisa, and then final Sharia has taken the form, the Sharia of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Suratul Maidah. So actually the legal injunctions of the Quran, and secondly, Jihad fi sabilillah, Infaq fi sabilillah, Qital fi sabilillah. These are the two subjects discussed in the second half of this surah, and there it's the address to the present Muslim Ummah. Now with this introduction, brief introduction, we start. The first two rukus of this surah are very important. If we keep it view, as I told you, Tawilul Khas, when they were revealed, what was meant and what was understood basically, by these wordings, by these ayat, when they were revealed at that time. And then we shall have the generalized view, that if we just leaving away the historical background, if we focus our attention on the wordings, then the generalized inferences, then we shall discuss about them. Alif Lam Mim, these are the isolated letters of the Quran which appear in the beginning of 29 surahs of the Quran. In 3 surahs only single letter comes. Qaf, Noon, Qaf wal Quran al Majid, Noon wal Qalam wa ma yasturun, Saad wal Quran al Zikr. Then in some there are 2 letters, Hameen, Taha, Yasin. In some there are 3 letters, Alif Lam Mim, Alif Lam Ra. And in some there are 4 letters, Alif Lam Mim Ra, Alif Lam Mim Saad. And only 2, there are 5. Kaf, Ha, Ya, Ain, Saad. Ha, Mim, Ain, Sin, Kaf. And the meanings of these letters nobody knows. They are a secret between Allah and His Messenger. Although much has been said about these letters. But the consensus, general consensus is that nobody knows the real meanings with sure. There are certain judgments people have guessed something, but nothing definite. You can't be sure of those meanings. ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ. This is the book of Allah, Al-Kitab. This is the book. What does it mean? The book of Allah. لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ. There's no doubt in it. No doubt in it about its being revealed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then there is no doubt in its contents. Its contents are also above doubt. And its revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is also above doubt. Hudal lil muttaqeen. This is the guidance for the God-fearing. But I discussed this word, taqwa, in my Sunday lecture. Taqwa, you know, although generally piety, godliness, holiness, different words are used, but actually meanings are to save yourself. Muttaqeen, people who want to save themselves. Sinners what? From what? From the fire of hell, number one. Displeasure of Allah, number two. And basically, they have a moral sense within them. And they want to avoid and save themselves from evil. If this moral sense is active within them, then actually they will always be in search of the truth, in search of what we shall do. Those people who had given those, you know, who had prayed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, اِهْدِنَا الصِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ صِرَاطَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمْتَ عَلَيْهِمْ. It was their desire. It was their own search. They wanted to have the guidance. Now actually this is the relationship between Suratul Fatiha and Suratul Baqarah. You ask for guidance, هُدَى لِلْمُتَّقِيمِ. This is the guidance. The guidance is being given to you. And these are the don'ts and do's. Do these things and don't do these things. Go this way, don't go this way. There's danger this way. This is the safety. This way you are safe. So actually this guidance is given here, hudal lil muttaqeen. But as I discussed in that lecture, although we find in the 23rd section of this very surah, hudal lil nas, this has the guidance for all humanity. But you know, only those people will be able to avail of His guidance who have in themselves the search for truth and guidance, who want to have guidance. People who don't want to have any guidance, they will not be able to avail themselves of the guidance that Quran is giving. If somebody is not hungry, he will not, you know, look towards any food. That food might be very nourishing and very tasty, but he has no hunger. He can't take it. So actually there should be a hunger, then only you know what food is and how valuable it is, how much I need it. That is actually the need for guidance is taqwa, because you want to save yourself from going astray. You want to save yourself from evils. You want to save yourself from doom on the doomsday. If that desire is there, only then you will be able to avail of the guidance of the Quran. And who are those muttaqeen? الَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْغَيْبِ. Those who believe in the unseen, who know that the reality lies beyond the realm of our senses. Our senses, you know, they are very limited. And the real, the basic realities, they lie beyond. Just as Confucius, you know, a very famous thinker of China, he has been reported to have said, there's nothing more real than what cannot be seen, and that there is nothing more certain than what cannot be heard. Things which are not visible by these eyes, which cannot be heard through these ears, they are the most real things. Actually, what we have this within the realm of our senses, this is a very shallow, superficial part of reality. So this is the basic thing that if somebody, he denies, no, there's nothing beyond our perception, then he will not be able to avail of the guidance of this Quran. Only such a person who understands, who knows that our senses, these, you know, they can reach, but to a very limited extent. The reality lies beyond it. يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْغَيْبِ وَيُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةَ. And then they establish prayers, because that reality, the Al-Haq, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, now you should have some contact with Him, some communication with Him, and to have a regular communication with Him, you must establish prayers. وَمِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ يُنْفِقُونَ. And whatsoever we have given them, they spend out of it. Spend out for charity, for the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for the spreading of the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for making the deen of Allah supreme. وَالَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِمَا أُنزِلَ إِلَيْكَ وَمَا أُنزِلَ مِنْ قَبْلِكَ. And those who believe in what has been revealed and sent down to you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And not only you, but they believe also on what was sent before. They believe in Torah also, they believe in Injil also, they believe in Zabur also, and they believe that the prophets have been given these revelations and guidances before Quran also. وَبِالْآخِرَةِ هُمْ يُوْقِنُونَ. Here, you know, we find the word is changed. Not يُؤْمِنُونَ, but يُوْقِنُونَ. About the hereafter, they are convinced, they are sure. They are sure that this life is not all human life. The real human life is in the hereafter. Death is not the end of our existence. It's just the gate towards the eternity. Because after death, you know, there is going to be resurrection. And after that resurrection, وَإِنَّهَا لَجَنَّةٌ أَبَدًا أَوْ لَنَارٌ أَبَدًا. It's eternity, eternal existence. So actually death is the gate to eternity. Actually they are convinced, they have the yaqeen. وَبِالْآخِرَةِ هُمْ يُوْقِنُونَ أُولَٰئِكَ عَلَىٰ هُدًى مِّن رَبِّهِمْ. This Allah is very important here. These are the people who are on the guidance from their Lord. They are already on the guidance. And they will be increased in their guidance. But they are already in the guidance. وَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُفْلِحُونَ. And they are the people who will be successful, who will reach their final goal. That is falah. Now please note here, what these ayat denote is that because Quran was being revealed for last 12 years before the revelation of these ayat, there were people who had taken the guidance of Quran. They were transformed, their characters, their seerah. They have been, you know, and they were practically present. These ayat are practically pointing towards those people. They are the people. There is Abu Bakr. Look to him. He is the fruit of this Quran. You know, every tree is known by the fruit it bears. The guidance of this Quran has produced a jama'ah, a group, a community of people like Abu Bakr, Umar, Osman, Talha, Zubair. Go and see. They are the people who have benefited themselves with the guidance, from the guidance of this Quran. And the Quran, you know, has produced a certain community who have these characters. الَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْغَيْبِ وَيُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةِ وَمِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ يُنْفِقُونَ وَالَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِمَا أُنزِلَ إِلَيْكَ وَمَا أُنزِلَ مِنْ قَبْلِكَ وَبِالْآخِرَةِ هُمْ يُوقِنُونَ أُولَٰئِكَ عَلَىٰ هُدًى مِّن رَّبِّهِمْ وَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُفْلِحُونَ. So this is actually the ta'wilul khas. When these ayat were revealed, as if these ayat were pointing towards the people whom Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had prepared by the hard work of 12 years, their training, their tazkiyah, their tarbiyah, and through the teaching of this Quran, يُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةِ. The teaching of this Quran and Hikmah has produced a people, a community. And these are these people whose qualities and attributes are given here. But if you infer generally, what will be the inference? If anybody wants actually to avail of the guidance of the Quran, he must take to this path first. He must produce in himself the qualities that are being given here, as if they are the precondition to avail the guidance of the Quran. If you want to tread on the path that Quran wants you to tread, these are the fundamental conditions, rather we should say preconditions, that you have to fulfill in order to avail yourself fully with the guidance of the Quran. Now the second group. Three types of people are discussed in these two rukus. Second, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا سَوَاءٌ عَلَيْهِمْ أَنذَرْتَهُمْ أَمْ لَمْ تُنذِرْهُمْ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ خَتَمَ اللَّهُ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبِهِمْ وَعَلَىٰ سَمْعِهِمْ وَعَلَىٰ أَبْصَارِهِمْ غِشَاوَةٌ وَلَهُمْ عَذَابٌ عَظِيمٌ. Verily those people who have denied, who have decided to be kuffar, to deny, سَوَاءٌ عَلَيْهِمْ, for them it's equal. أَنذَرْتَهُمْ, whether you warn them, أَمْ لَمْ تُنذِرْهُمْ, or you don't warn them. لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ, they are not going to believe. Now actually, here also Quran is pointing towards certain people. This is not general. So many people were kuffar, had not become Muslims till these ayat were revealed, and they became Muslims later on. So it cannot be a generalized meaning. Actually, it's a particular group. Those people whom Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam had preached for 12 years at Makkah, and they had understood the message of the Quran, and from the depths of their heart they believed that this is correct, but they didn't want to accept it due to their haughtiness, due to their takabbur, due to their ghurur, because you know they were proud. They didn't want to follow Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Why should we follow Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam? Are we inferior to Muhammad? No. Then you know this is actually when they had decided, oh Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, it is equal. It's equally fruitless or equally without any result. Whether you preach them anymore, whether you go on warning them anymore, or you stop preaching to them and warning them. لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ, they are not going to believe. They have decided to remain kafir. They will not accept you. خَتَمَ اللَّهُ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبِهِمْ, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has put a seal on their hearts. وَعَلَىٰ سَمِعِهِمْ, and on their ears, their hearing. وَعَلَىٰ أَبْصَارِهِمْ غِشَاوَةٌ, and on their eyes, there is a curtain. There is covering on their eyes. وَلَهُمْ عَذَابٌ عَظِيمٌ, and for them is waiting a very big torment. Now this again, please note, those people to whom preaching was done, the message of Quran had been conveyed to them year after year. 12 years Muhammad took Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam at Makkah. Abu Jahl, Abu Lahab, it is not that they didn't understand. They understood. Quran was in their own language. And they knew Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam from the very birth. Abu Lahab at least knew him from his very birth. But you know, they had decided not to accept him due to their haughtiness, their proudness. So actually now such people, they will not avail of your guidance. They will not avail of the guidance of the Quran. They will not benefit, O Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, from your preaching, from your warning. So it's equal to them. And because due to their refusal to accept the truth, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had punished them by putting a seal on their hearts. This seal is not in the beginning. This seal is put only when somebody refrains from accepting the truth. Recognizing the truth that this is true, his heart tells him this is true, accept it, and he doesn't accept. Why? Because of proudness, or because of certain such reasons, haughtiness. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as a punishment puts his seal on his heart. Now he cannot see because there is a curtain before their eyes. They cannot hear because their hearing is also sealed. And now their hearts are closed to for any guidance. وَمِنَ النَّاسِ, now the third degree, third type of people. وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَقُولُ آمَنَّا بِاللَّهِ وَبِالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ وَمَا هُمْ بِمُؤْمِنِينَ, And there are from among people who say with their tongues, with their mouths, Amanna billah, we believe in Allah, wa bil yawmil akhir, and the last day, the day of judgment, wa ma hum bi mu'minin, and they are not mu'min, they are not real believers. They profess to believe, they claim to believe, they say with loud words, we believe in Allah, we believe in the hereafter, in the day of judgment, but they are not believers. Now who are they? First of all, please note, they are actually two categories who are being referred here without giving them any name. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has not given them any title. But as far as we can understand, there are two types of people who are being discussed here. Generally, people think that they are only munafiqeen, the hypocrites. But actually, hypocrites as well as the Jews of Medina, both are included in this category. And actually, hypocrites were also people under the influence of the Jews of Medina. They were under their influence. And they were the shayateen, people which we shall very presently read in these ayat also the word. وَإِذَا خَلَوْا إِلَىٰ شَيَاطِينِهِمْ قَالُوا إِنَّا مَعَاكُمْ إِنَّمَا نَحْنُ مُسْتَحْزِئُونَ So actually this description, as you say in English, free to whom it fits, this is a narration and it fits two groups of people of that time. Number one, the Jews. Number two, the Munafiqun, the hypocrites, who said they were Muslims, but they were not Muslims, they were not Mormons. Why Jews? Because here you find, يَقُولُ آمَنَّا بِاللَّهِ وَبِالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ Not بِالْرَسُول. Here the wordings are only that they say we believe in Allah and believe in hereafter, but not in the Rasul. We don't believe in the Messenger. At least this is not their saying. And that was the position of the Jews, because we believe in Allah. And you also believe in Allah, we also believe in Allah. You also believe in unity of Allah, we also believe in unity of Allah. You also believe in the resurrection? We also believe in the resurrection. You also believe in the hereafter? In the heaven and hell? We also believe in the hereafter and the hell and the heaven. So we are also Mormons. You must accept us as believers. That was their claim. And it's very noteworthy that out of the three basic imaniyat, three basic themes of iman, only two have been mentioned. وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَقُولُ آمَنَّا بِاللَّهِ وَبِالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ وَمَا هُمْ بِمُؤْمِنِينَ They are not Mormons. And in the same way, and when we shall read the description, this fits, you know, the Munafiqun of Medina also. Because they also actually, they doubted about the messengership of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We find in the Quran at different places that they said, for example, why these wars have been started, battles have been started. There is no express injunction in the Quran. لَوْلَا نُزِلَتْ سُورَةٌ Why not a surah has been revealed in the Quran? And only on this demand of theirs, we find that Suratul Qital was revealed. Suratul Muhammad or Suratul Qital in the 26th part, which contains a very express injunction for going to war against the kuffar. So actually, they were not very sure about the messengership or prophethood of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They were their claim was, Iman billah, Iman bil akhir. Actually, they took Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam not very seriously. And to obey Muhammad personally, that had become most difficult for them. So these both groups are included here. If you keep in view the Tawilul Khas, the groups who are in the background of these ayat. But when we shall infer generally, this will fit every munafiq for all times to come. Because, as a rule, please understand, whenever there is some ideological call, when there is some revolutionary movement started based on some ideology, you will always find three types of people. There are people who accept the ideology at its face value, and then they are ready to die for it, live for it, to do whatever it demands. Then there are people who are opposed to that ideology. They oppose it clearly, openly, tooth and nail. And then there is the third group always, who want to support the ideology, but keep safe themselves. They want to play safe. They don't want to sacrifice their belongings or their lives. They want to be safe. and you know, to keep their money with them. And everything, you see, they don't want to take risks. And they want to do something good, but it should happen itself. Not that we have to do anything for it, and we have to sacrifice anything for it. So these are the munafiqun, the third type of people, who will always be found with every ideological movement, every revolutionary movement. People who believe it, take it at its face value, they plunge into deep waters, risking everything. People who refuse to accept and who oppose it tooth and nail, clearly. And people who are in between, la ilaha ulai wa la ilaha ulai. They are neither on that side, neither on this side. They are somewhat on this side, somewhat on that side. Meaning thereby, neither on their side, neither on this side. So these are the munafiqun, and this is the third group which is being discussed here. وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَقُولُ آمَنَّا بِاللَّهِ وَبِالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ وَمَا هُمْ بِمُؤْمِنِينَ. And they are not believers, they are not the real mu'mins. يُخَادِعُونَ اللَّهَ وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. They try to deceive. يُخَادِعُونَ, I've added the word try. They are trying to deceive Allah and the people who believe, the real believers. Mukhada'a, this is Baba Mufa'ala, this is trying against each other. So yukhadi'un Allah wal-lazina amanu, they are trying to deceive Allah and people who believe, the mu'mins. Wama yakhda'una illa anfusahum, and they are not deceiving anybody except themselves. They are deceiving themselves. When they claim they are mu'min, they are deceiving themselves. When they think that they can please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through this verbal attestation only, well, they are wrong. They are deceiving themselves. وَمَا يَشْعُرُونَ, but they perceive it not. They have not the sense that they are deceiving themselves. وَلَا يَشْعُرُونَ فِي قُلُوبِهِمْ مَرَضٌ. In their hearts, there is a disease. There is an ailment. That ailment is of doubt. Shak, rab, doubt. And this is actually, this shak and rab, then it goes to develop into nifaq, into hypocrisy. فِي قُلُوبِهِمْ مَرَضٌ فَزَادَهُمُ اللَّهُ مَرَضًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has increased them in their disease. This is the rule of Allah. This is the sunnah of Allah. This is the habit of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you take to the right path, He will help you in proceeding forward on that right path. If you choose the wrong path, He will help you. Go ahead, further and further. And if you are in between, He will leave you there. It's your own choice. Imma shakiram wa imma kafura. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given the choice to you, to me, to every human being. When the decision He makes, Allah makes that way easy for Him to proceed further and further. All the difficulties of the right path, they are made easier for Him. All the big evils of the wrong path, for those people who choose to take that wrong path for themselves, then they are made easy for Him. And they go after one big evil to the another bigger evil, and then to the still bigger evil, they go forward. So actually this is the habit of Allah. فِي قُلُوبِهِمْ مَرَضٌ فَزَادَهُمُ اللَّهُ مَرَضًا. Allah has increased them in their disease. وَلَهُمْ عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ. And there, for them is a very painful torment. بِمَا كَانُوا يَكْسِبُونَ. On the basis of, because of the lie that they had been telling. Because they were saying we are mu'mins, they were not mu'mins. This was the lie that they were saying, they were telling. وَإِذَا قِيلَ لَهُمْ لَا تُفْسَدُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ. Now it's very important. This third category of people, as I told you, one type of people who accept that da'wah, that call, that ideology, and then they plunge into deep waters, risking everything. Other one, they have rejected the ideology, rather they have decided to oppose it, and they are opposing it tooth and nail. And then this third group is in between. They want to make peace between evil and good, between batil and haq. They want to make peace between them. Because if there is a clash between the batil and the haq, between the truth and the falsehood, if there is a clash, there is going to be bloodshed, there is going to be loss of life, loss of property, loss of conveniences, everything. So actually they want peace, not for the sake of their truth, but for themselves, to save themselves. That is why they wanted to say that why are we going to war? It's no use going to war against kuffar. Why not go on preaching and preaching and teaching and teaching? Well, we can preach Islam. We can teach Islam to the people. Why Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam has taken this way? He started sending small groups of armies, small groups, obstructing the way of the caravans, of the Quraysh. What for? Why? This will lead to bloodshed. This will lead to war, to battles. We shouldn't do it. We should make peace. Now this character, you must read between the lines. وَإِذَا قِيلَ لَهُمْ لَا تُفْسِدُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ قَالُوا إِنَّمَا نَحْنُ مُسْلِحُونَ. When it is said to them, don't make mischief on the earth, they say, oh no, we are the peacemakers. What was the mischief? Muslims, the true Mu'mins, said to them, if you accepted Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as the messenger of Allah, if you accepted Islam, then be true Muslims. Now obey him in every respect. When you have accepted him, now you have to obey him. Why you know this difference of opinion? This is actually mischief. This is fasad. لا تُسْتَدُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ. There is a party. You are breaking the discipline of the party. This party must be disciplined. بُنْيَانٌ مَرْسُوسٌ إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ الَّذِينَ يُقَاتِلُونَ فِي سَبِيلِهِ صَفًّا كَأَنَّهُمْ بُنْيَانٌ مَرْسُوسٌ. You should be like, you know, a fortified wall. Not different people, individuals, you know. So this group should be very much integrated. And why are you making this facade? And the reply was, قَالُوا إِنَّمَا نَحْنُ مُسْلِحُونَ. No, we want to make peace. Muhammad wants to make war, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And we want to obstruct this war-mongering. We want to have peace. أَلَا إِنَّهُمْ هُمُ الْمُفْسِدُونَ. Now this is the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Listen, they are the mischief-mongers. وَلَاكِ اللَّهِ يَشْعُرُونَ. But they don't have the perception, they perceive not. But they are the mischief mongers. Why? Because actually, whenever on this earth there is some system which is not the system of Deen of Allah, this is fasad. Although there might be all amn, all peace, apparent peace, but actually when this is not the law of Allah which is governing this place, it is in rebellion against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is fasad. Zahara al-fasadu fil barri wal bahr bima kasabat yadi an-nas. This is fasad. This is rebellion against the rightful ruler. The rightful owner of this universe is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is the only rightful ruler. And if anybody else, any other law is ruling, it is rebellion. So this rebellion has to be set under. It has to be controlled. It has to be dealt with. And for dealing with this rebellion, putting it down, you need a party, strong party, powerful party, disciplined party. Now if you are making injuries to the discipline of that party, you are weakening that party, you are abetting this system actually, this facade. So Quran says, Ala innahum humul mufsidun. By breaking the discipline of the Muslim party, of Hizbullah, of the party of Allah and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they are the mischief mongers. They are abetting and supporting this facade on earth. Ala innahum humul mufsiduna walakin la yashurun. Wa idha qila lahum aminu kama amanu nas. And when it is said to them, you should also believe just as the others have believed. You look to Abu Bakr, look to Umar, look to Sa'd ibn Ma'az, look to Sa'd ibn Ubadah, radiyallahu ta'ala anhu majma'in. They are the believers. Why don't you follow them? Why don't you take to their examples? What did they say? Very interesting. وَإِذَا قِيلَ لَهُمْ آمِنُوا كَمَا آمَنَ النَّاسِ قَالُوا أَنُؤْمِنُوا كَمَا آمَنَ السُّفَهَا. They said, should we believe just as these fools are believing? They thought they are fools. They are fanatics. They are risking everything. These are fools who have left their homes and hearts and they have come over from Makkah to Medina. Are they wise people? They don't look to whatever is injurious to them, whatever is harmful to them, whatever is beneficial for them. They have just migrated from Mecca, leaving their families, their home, not only their homes and hearts, their families, at the mercy of the wolves of Makkah. They have come over here. And they are fools. Actually, we are not fools like them. We are not going to risk our lives and properties and our wealth. We are not going to take that part. وَإِذَا قِيلَ لَهُمْ آمِنُوا كَمَا آمَنَ السُّفَهَاءُ آمَنُوا كَمَا آمَنَ النَّاسُ قَالُوا أَنُؤْمِنُ كَمَا آمَنَ السُّفَهَاءُ أَلَا إِنَّهُمْ هُمُ السُّفَهَاءُ وَلَٰكِنْ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. Listen to it. Hearken. They are the fools, but they don't have the perception. They don't have the knowledge. Abu Bakr is not a fool. Umar is not a fool. And Saad ibn Ibadah and Saad ibn Maaz, they are not fools. These are fools. Abdullah ibn Ubay is the biggest fool of Medina. And the people who are like him, people who are obeying him, people who are taking his part, they are the fools. Because actually they don't know what is really good and beneficial for them. Because real life is the life hereafter. And this is injurious for them. Because we read in Surah An-Nisa, إِنَّ الْمُنَافِقِينَ فِي الدَّرْكِ الْأَسْفَلِ مِنَ النَّارِ. These munafiqeen will be in the lowest part of hell, in the lowest section of hell, they will be placed. So actually they are fools. وَإِذَا لَقُوا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا قَالُوا آمَنَّا. And when they meet the people who believe, really believe, they say, we also believe. وَإِذَا خَلَوْا إِلَىٰ شَيَاطِينِهِمْ. Now this is the word, please note. When they are in privacy with their devils, with their chiefs, well, these are the chiefs, the Jews of Medina. The munafiqeen were actually, they were in close liaison with the Jews of Medina. وَإِذَا خَلَوْا إِلَىٰ شَيَاطِينِهِمْ قَالُوا إِنَّا مَعَكُمْ. There they say, we are with you. Don't think, although we have openly declared ourselves to be Muslims, to be with the Muslims, to be with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but this is also, we are making mockery of them. We are with you really. We have not left your side. We are with you. وَإِذَا لَقُوا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا قَالُوا آمَنَّا. وَإِذَا خَلَوْا إِلَىٰ شَيَاطِينِهِمْ قَالُوا إِنَّا مَعَكُمْ إِنَّمَا نَحْنُ مُسْتَهْزِئُونَ. We are only mocking. We are these fools, you know, these moments, they are fools. And we are making a laughing stock for them. اللَّهُ يَسْتَهْزِئُ بِهِمْ. Now this is the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah mocks at them. وَيَمُدُّهُمْ فِي تُغْيَانِهِمْ. Again the same divine habit or divine rule or the sunnah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whichever path you take, Allah makes it easy for you. وَيَمُدُّهُمْ فِي تُغْيَانِهِمْ يَعْمَهُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives them increase in their wrongdoings, permits them going more and more in the direction of that evil and wrong path that they have taken and decided and chosen for themselves. أُولَٰئِكَ الَّذِينَ اشْتَرَوُوا الضَّلَالَةَ بِالْهُدَىٰ. They are the people who have purchased error, falsehood, in exchange for guidance. Very beautiful words. Now guidance of the Qur'an came to them. Now they have two options. Either accept the guidance of the Qur'an, or the opposite of it, that's the falsehood, that is batil, that is error, that is sin, that is disobedience to Allah. Actually now, they have given away the guidance of Quran, guidance of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and taken for themselves, accepting for themselves, they have exchanged the guidance for zalala, for the error, the falsehood. فَمَا رَبِحَتْ تِجَارَتُهُمْ. And this trade of theirs, it has not benefited them at all. This is the sort of tafsirah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, a commentary from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. أُولَٰئِكَ الَّذِينَ اشْتَرَبُوا الظَّلَالَةَ بِالْهُدَىٰ فَمَا رَبِحَتْ تِجَارَتُهُمْ وَمَا كَانُوا مُهْتَدِينَ. And they are not going to reach the destiny. They cannot have now the guidance because they have gone very far on this path of nifaq and munafiqah. مَثَلُهُمْ كَمَثَلِ الَّذِي اسْتَوْقَدَ نَارًا. Now there are two similes here. And there are two opinions. One opinion is that both these similes are regarding this third category, the in-between people, neither this side nor this side. لَا إِلَهَا أُولَٰي وَلَا إِلَهَا أُولَٰي مُزَبْزَبِينَ بَيْنَ ذَلِكُ. Neither the believers nor opposing, apparently or openly, in-between. and the both the, you know, parables or both these similitudes, they are about these very people. Some are very deep in this quality of hypocrisy, and some are shallow. But the opinion which I hold, and I agree with the people who think that way, that is that the first simile is for the kuffar, and the second simile is for the munafiqeen. For the kuffar, we read these ayat, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا سَوَاءٌ عَلَيْهِمْ أَأَنذَرْتَهُمْ أَمْ لَمْ تُنذِرْهُمْ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ ختم الله على قلوبهم وعلى سمعهم وعلى أبصارهم غشاوة ولهم عذاب عظيم. For them now there is a misal, a similitude, a similitude. مثلهم كمثل الذي استوقد نارا. Their likeness is as the likeness of one who kindled a fire. Now this is actually a situation which you can imagine. It commonly happened to the Arab people when they used to travel in the desert. Now a caravan is traveling during the night. And they used to travel during the night, mostly, because the days were very hot. One couldn't take, you know, to travel in the daytime. So during the night. And it did sometime happen that they lost the way. Now they are lost, where we are. And darkness. And in that darkness, somebody takes the courage, gathers some timber, and then, you know, kindles a fire. Now they can see where they are, their whereabouts, where are we. But at this moment, something happens to a group of people that their sight is gone. So they are again in the darkness. Before that fire, there was darkness outside, although their own sights were intact. But now the mahal, the environment, the surroundings are enlightened, but their sight is gone. So they are again in the darkness. This is the position of those. Actually, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam kindled the fire and light of Hidayah. But there were certain peoples who, out of jealousy, out of their haughtiness, they didn't like to see the light of the day. So actually their sight was taken away by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and now they are groping in the darkness. Summun bukmun umyun fahum la yarji'un. This is the likeness of the people of the second group. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا سَوَاءٌ عَلَيْهِمْ أَأَنذَرْتَهُمْ أَمْ لَمْ تُنذِرْهُمْ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ خَتَمَ اللَّهُ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبِهِمْ وَعَلَىٰ سَمْعِهِمْ وَعَلَىٰ أَبْصَارِهِمْ غِشَاوَةٌ وَلَهُمْ عَذَابٌ عَظِيمٌ. مَثَلُهُمْ كَمَثَلِ الَّذِي اسْتَوْقَدَ نَارًا. Their likeness is to the likeness of a one person who kindled a fire. فَلَمَّا أَضَاءَتْ مَا حَوْلَهُ. And when it lighted all around him, ذَهَبَ اللَّهُ بِنُورِهِمْ. Allah took away their sights. وَتَرَكَهُمْ فِي ظُلُمَاتِ لَا يُبْصِرُونَ. And now left them in the darknesses, they cannot see anything. سُمٌ بُكْمٌ عُمْيٌ فَهُمْ لَا يَرْجِعُونَ. They are deaf, they are dumb, they are blind, and they are not going to return. They cannot return. Don't hope, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or you, O Muslims, that any one of them will ever return to the path of Allah. Because now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has taken away their sights. خَتَمَ اللَّهُ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبِهِ وَعَلَىٰ سَمِعِ وَعَلَىٰ أَبْصَارِهِمْ غِشَاوَةٌ. So I think that this simile is for that group. And for the munafiqeen of second simile. أَوْ كَسَيِّبٍ مِّنَ السَّمَاءِ. Or the similitude of a rainstorm. فِيهَ ظُلُمَاتٌ وَرَعْدٌ وَبَرْقٌ. There is a rainstorm from the sky, wherein there is darkness and thunder and lightning. يَجْعَلُونَ أَصَابِعُمْ فِي آذَانِهِمْ مِنَ السَّوَائِقِ حَذَرَ الْمَوْتِ. They are putting their fingers in their ears, saving themselves from death due to the stunning thunderclap. They think that this sound will take their hearing away, and then maybe they die out of it. قَسَيِّبٍ مِّنَ السَّمَاءِ فِيهِ ظُلُمَاتٌ وَرَعْدٌ وَبَرْقٌ. يَجْعَلُونَ أَصَابِعَهُمْ فِي آذَانِهِمْ مِنَ السَّوَائِقِ حَذَرَ الْمَوْتِ وَاللَّهُ مُحِيطٌ بِالْكَافِرِينَ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has already encompassed and encircled these kuffar. Where can they go? They are within the grip of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They cannot go anywhere. They cannot run away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. يَقَادُ الْبَرْقُ يَخْطَفُ أَبْصَارَهُمْ. The lightning almost is near to snatch their sights. kullama adalahum mashawfi. Whenever there is some light, they can see something. The lightning for a time, for a moment, they have seen the environment, they start going in the direction. Mashawfi, they walk a few steps. Wa iza azlama alayhim qamu. And when there is darkness upon them, they stand. وَلَوْ شَاءَ اللَّهُ لَذَهَبَ بِسَمْعِهِمْ وَأَبْصَارِهِمْ. And had Allah decided or decreed, He would have taken away from them their sight and hearing both. إِنَّ اللَّهَ عَلَىٰ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٍ. Verily Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is all powerful. He has all authority. He can do anything He likes. Now just have some thought about this simile. You know, whenever there is some revolutionary dawah, revolutionary movement, there are difficulties. You are called to do your duties in face of difficulties and risks. There are risks of life, risks of wealth. Now you may have to suffer, and you may have to give up your careers. You may have to give up and wind up your businesses. Because that has been the requirement of every revolutionary struggle. Now these people who are in between, they are belonging to the category who want to do something but without any harm to themselves. They don't want to take any risk to their life, their wealth, their property and so on. So what happens? Whenever during the movement there comes a time when there is no immediate risk. There is no call to go to war, for example. During the Madani period, whenever there was a call to go to war for any battle, then they were, you know, in a very big trouble. How to save themselves? What, you know, how to apologize? How to get leave from that? But whenever there is all the conditions are normal, nothing very risky affair, then they can, you know, walk with the Muslims. We are also Muslims. And they join the Muslims in congregations. They talk loudly about their Islam and Iman. They make tall claims about their sincerity. But when there is a difficult time of trial and tribulation, then you know they go down and their courage is gone. So that is the condition portrayed in this similitude. That whenever there is some light, they see something, they can go. They take a few steps. They go ahead. But then again, when there is darkness, there is again difficulty, there is again risk for life or property or wealth, they again stand and they don't move. So this is the condition of those people about whom the description we have already seen. وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَقُولُ آمَنَّا بِاللَّهِ وَبِالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ وَمَا هُمْ بِمُؤْمِنِينَ يُخَادِعُونَ اللَّهَ وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَمَا يَخْدَعُونَ إِلَّا أَنفُسَهُمْ وَمَا يَشْعُرُونَ. There are from among peoples who claim that they are Mu'mins, they believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they believe in the life hereafter, in the day of judgment, but actually they don't believe. It's a superficial claim that they are making. It's only a verbal attestation that they are doing, or they are making a total false claim. They are like the Jews. So this description fits both of them. And they were in close association with each other. Actually, this Munafiqat and, you know, Munafiqeen, they were like undergrowth. You know, there are big trees, tall trees. Under those big trees, there is the undergrowth which we call bushes. So these Munafiqeen were like the undergrowth of the Jews. They were the established people, three established tribes. They were very influential. They were very wealthy. They were, you know, educated people. They had the book, they had the law, they had Torah. They had people, learned people within them. So actually this Munafiqeen, this third category was an undergrowth under that Jews. And this is the description of this character. And when we generalize it, always with every revolutionary call and movement, you will find three types of people. People who accept the call at its face value. And then they die for it, they live for it. They take every risk for it. They are ready to sacrifice their all belongings, even their lives. People who are opposed to it, tooth and nail, openly. Because they are the people whose vested interests are threatened by the revolutionary party or the revolutionary dawah. They oppose it tooth and nail. And there is always a third group which likes that something good should happen, but they are not ready to sacrifice anything for that. They want to play safe, to keep safe. There is a very important and very beautiful similitude in Surah Al-Hajj also. I told you Surah Al-Hajj, you know, that is in between Makki and Madani surahs. In Surah Al-Hajj there is an ayah, وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَعْبُدُ اللَّهَ عَلَىٰ حَرْفٍ. There are from among people who want to worship Allah, but keeping themselves on the sides. They don't want to plunge the main current. وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَعْبُدُ اللَّهَ عَلَىٰ حَرْفٍ فَإِنْ أَصَابَهُ خَيْرٌ اِطْمَعَنَّ بِهِ. If there is khair, if there is safety, if there is, you know, all the sureties and everything is okay, اِطْمَعَنَّ بِهِ, he is also satisfied. He is also going along with the mu'mineen. وَإِنْ أَصَابَتْهُ فِتْنَةٌ انْقَلَبَ عَلَىٰ وَجْهِهِ. And whenever there is some trial, tribulation, when there is a period of testing, when there is a call for sacrifice, for spending for the cause of Allah, a call for going to the battlefield for the cause of Allah, انْقَلَبَ عَلَىٰ وَجْهِهِ, they fall down on their faces, fall down on the ground on their faces. خَسِرَ الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةِ. This is actually the real loss. Loss of this world also, and real loss of the Akhirah. ذَلِكَ هُوَ الْخُسْرَانُ الْمُبِينَ. And this is the real loss. This is the real danger to which a man is putting himself. So that is actually the description of this. And I think the time is also over. No? 2 minutes. Let us proceed to the first ayah of the third section. يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ اعْبُدُوا رَبَّكُمُ الَّذِي خَلَقَكُمْ وَالَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. Instead of giving you the translation, let me give you the introduction to the third and fourth sections. These two sections of this surah, as I told you in the beginning, they give you a gist and a summary of number one, the call of Quran. What's the call of Quran? Number one. And number two, the basic philosophy of Quran. All these subjects have been discussed in detail in the Makki surahs. But you know, as I told you, that because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed a Madani surah in the very beginning of the Mushaf, the gist and summary of that Makki Quran is given here in two sections. Very important. What's the basic call of Quran? That we will find in the third section, third ruku. What's the basic philosophy of Quran? What's the position of man in this universe? On what basis that position has been given to him? And what is the struggle of between evil and good that is going on throughout the history? The struggle within a man, within the personality. There is a struggle always going on within our personalities between good and evil. Something is taking us towards evil and something wants to take us towards good, towards virtue. This is a struggle. A war is going on in the inner, you know, battlefield of our personalities. And then there is a war going on the outside world. There is the philosophy of history of Quran, that this is a struggle between the forces of evil and forces of virtue and good. There is the forces of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on one side and the forces of shaitan on the other side. Dunya ko hai phir maar ka hai rooho badan pesh. Iblis ne phir apne darindo ko ubhara. Allah ko paabar diye momin pe bharosa. Iblis ko Europe ki machino ka sahara. So that struggle is going on. Satira kar raha hai azal se taim roz. Chirag-e Mustafavi se sharar-e Bulahbi. That struggle has been going on. But what is the basis of that struggle? That will be discussed in the fourth section, inshallah. And that those two sections, inshallah, we shall study in the next session. بارك الله لي ولكم في القرآن العظيم ونفعني وإياكم بالآيات والذكر الحكيم.
الله أكبر الله أكبر.
The Islamic Organization of North America, IONA, is an organization dedicated to reviving the Quran into the hearts of Muslims while bringing its message to non-Muslims. The obligations of a Muslim as ordained by the Quran and Sunnah can be understood as having four levels. 1. A Muslim is required to develop real faith and conviction, iman, in one's heart. 2. A Muslim is required to live a life of complete submission to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. 3. A Muslim is required to propagate and disseminate the message of Islam to humanity as a whole. 4. A Muslim is required to try his utmost in establishing the just Islamic order. The first and foremost objective of establishing IONA is to assist the Muslims in North America to uphold and implement these obligations, first on themselves, their families, inform their friends, and then to invite the non-Muslims to Islam. The ultimate goal is to seek Allah's pleasure and salvation in the hereafter. For more information about IONA, please visit us at www.tanzeem.us. You may also email us at info@tanzeem.us or call our toll-free number 866-779-IONA. Join us. Together we can make a difference.